Good morning, everybody. We're coming to you live right here from inside the brand new state-of-the-art facility, Lake Park, Florida, at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. I'm Tom. Ladies' band's off today, and the Master Bubba's right behind us, getting ready to exit stage right. You can see the new set we've been working on for you, ladies and gentlemen, so we can bring you newer items, newer topics, and a better visual background. Floors are next. Ladies and gentlemen, good Friday morning. We welcome you to Doin It Bubba Style, the number one rated internationally syndicated motorsports live stream. And here's the host of the show himself, the Master. You see him on Instagram, Facebook, everywhere, ladies and gentlemen. One of the top in the industry today. Good morning, Bub. How are you doing today?
Hey, you know, doing pretty good so far. Trying to figure out why this thing still doesn't notify me in our pocket that we're live, so obviously still settings that just don't work.
Bub, this is a 1975 Corvette. This new show is going to be all technical. This vet came into you on a trailer, Bub. It was literally in pieces. The owner bought this thing in pieces, Bub. Tell us a little bit about it.
So, yeah, man, let me tell you, when we talk about a car that came in a basket case and a ton of boxes, this was one of them.
Yes, it
and
was.
Pretty mind-blowing to see this thing go from what it was to where it is now, as you guys see it behind us. We are on the final detail work and the final...
Ladies and gentlemen, our paint and body foreman walking right in front of us.
You know what? I really don't give a shit.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our paint and body foreman right here, Jason.
This guy
good morning,
thinks we're
Jason.
Just talking over to the corner of the shop for some reason. Jesus. Anyways, we are down to the final detail stuff that we are doing. As you can see, Jason's now bringing over the T-tops from the paint and body shop next door behind us. And he's doing that, of course, that seven-step polish, which is everything that we always do here at BEM from 1,000 to 1,500 to 2,500. Then you do your three, then you have your three steps of polish. So seven steps total from all that 3M product. And let me tell you, the shine comes out insane. This thing has already had one of those complete steps done, but we are going to do a final polish here over the next couple hours right before this thing hits the streets of South Florida. And Jesus, I don't know, maybe 3 hours?
Bub, you know what? Tell us a little bit about the history of the car. Like I said, it came in on a trailer. The owner really wanted the 75 vet. He's always been very much in favor of it. You went and sharpened all of these lines on the body with this. The car was, there was no paint on this car at all.
Yeah, no, it was pretty rough, man. It was, you know, for fiberglass cars, right? Like, you know that fiberglass typically has, over years, paint starts cracking from the bottom up. Like, you
yes.
start seeing that fiberglass separate and the hair is coming through. So this was exactly that case. And I'm talking, I don't know, 10 different colors, you know,
yes,
whites, browns, yeah. grays. There's all kinds of stuff going on in this thing. Orange, there's some red that I just found inside the front door jam when I was doing the jams.
Oh,
a minute
no,
ago.
You just painted it,
so
Bob.
It's like, man, I don't know how many colors this thing has been in its life, but there has been a ton of modification to this car in terms of over the years and other people's hands working on it. And it has made it that much harder of a restoration because nothing has fit like it should, but now it is all exactly the way it should be back in 75. The weather strip channels, all the roof moldings, all of that stuff was literally like all the stainless trim for some reason, just holes randomly drilled everywhere, like somebody
yeah.
couldn't make it fit, so they would just kind of drill holes and rivet it in. And that's not the way you do things. You figure out what's wrong, you make sure that you go through step by step to get it exactly the way it should be, and then that gives you a perfect job when it's done.
Hey, Bub, let's talk a little bit about the interior. It was a tan interior at one time. You've converted it to all black, brand new carpets in it, brand new seats in it, seat foam, all seat hardware. Somebody had even made a bracket for the bottom of this seat out of angle iron or tube iron.
Oh, let's not even talk about
well, that's
seats,
why I want people to understand what you went through to
so
make this work.
It was literally, I kid you not, it was like every part of the car, right? So some of you are probably out there watching. I'm sure there's purist Corvette guys out there. There always is. The Corvette Society is NCRS, right? National Corvette Restoration. So that company is huge in these things. They literally grade these things up to 1,000 grades, you know, grade scale.
Yep, you've
that's
had a couple.
Not what we went for on this car. This was a great frame-on restoration.
Frame-on,
we've
yes.
literally touched every part of the car, but it is not what it should be, right? So most people are looking at this like, well, that doesn't look like it's a 75 because of what you're seeing over my shoulder here, right? So this is a real 75 Corvette, but it does have an 81 rear bumper on it. So
interesting. I didn't know that.
I actually like the 81, 82 bumpers because they had this built-in little spoiler that you can call it at the back. I think it looked better than like the 75s were kind of, they went downward with the body of the car and kind of like rolled off. And then it had the two little black bumperettes that were molded into it. So it's like it didn't have a rear bumper on the car, but it had these two dildo looking things on the left and right side. It looked freaking terrible to me. And then most of those cars had like a chrome rack on the back for like driving across the USA.
Yeah.
I don't even know, man. But I thought they were really, really ugly years for these cars, but tastefully done with the 81 upgrade rear, but it's all done with GM parts and components, so everything does fit exactly like it should.
That's correct. You have used all OEM parts on this vehicle to get it back on its feet. Bob, you even went so far as to take care of all the underdash wiring on this and all new vents because you installed aftermarket AC on this car.
Yeah, you know, it's you know, those are the things that we like to do, right? So the Corvettes, what's nice about these, especially the C3 model line, well, even all the way back earlier than that, like the C2s, some of the C1s, you could get those cars optioned with factory four-wheel disc brake, right? Earlier model C1, C2, if you got four-wheel disc brake, you had typically manual brakes on them. This one is like a factory power option car. So this thing literally has power everything, power windows, power steering, power brakes. So it originally was an air conditioned car, but we did opt to get away from that big A6 compressor,
yes,
that old style R12 unit. And we did upgrade it with Classic Auto Air's firewall forward kit because it was a factory air car. So you buy a kit, completely direct fit, bolt on the brackets, the pulleys, charge the system up, convert it over to 134. It is modern, the cooling's incredible on the car. So it rides nice, super, super easy to drive. I've already cruised it all morning
around.
You
did. You drove it.
I didn't even have the door panels on yet, but I'm still out cruising this thing. It sounds super good, man. No creaks, no rattles,
no rattles,
typical Corvette clunky crap flopping all over the place. You hear the fiberglass bodies.
Yeah, creaking.
None of that's happening, man. This thing is tight and right.
I heard you use a couple terms, Bob. A6, C1, C2, C3. What do those mean?
So those are just, you know, for example, like I mentioned the compressor, the A6 style compressor, right? That was just that massive compressor that GM used. It had to be probably 35 pounds easily.
Yes, it
right?
was.
So
yeah,
it was a massive compressor that was used. The clutches turned on those things, and I'm telling
just
you,
clunk.
It was
yeah,
like you felt somebody put a freaking drag on the front of your motor. You would easily lose 20, 30 horsepower on the front of your motor when this thing was running, right? So that was that old GM style compressor, and it was used for a really long time, man, from, you know, early mid 50s all the way up through, heck, going into like just about that 80 range when
yeah,
it was, you know, still on like the Caprices, the 305s, 350s, things like that.
Then they went to that smaller one.
Then they went to the smaller Sandin style compressor, which is just the brand of the design of that compressor. Much more smaller, more compact, more functional, reliable. They had pressure switches, so it turned the system on and off, and it cycled the way it should, not just turn on and be a constant drag when you turn that switch on.
And Bob, what about like C1, C2, C3? Tell us a little bit about that, if you would, please.
So that was just a, you know, the model line of the Corvettes, right? So there was, you know, each generation, right? So you have your C1, C2, 3C, 3C4, and so on, all the way up to now C7 going into C8. So there are a ton of different model lines. This is that C3 body style.
Good morning to Mike Galbraith out there. How are you, Mike? How is everything going? Joe Kramer, good morning. He says hello to Jason, who caught us in there. Bob Snow, the snowman, said, hello, how are you? Snowman, how have you been doing? Hey, Jack's up there, and he was in Canada, right? He's in Canada? Isn't Jack up in Canada, I think it is?
Oh, which Jack we got here? Oh, yeah, I think so, yeah, Canada.
Hey, good morning, Jack. How are you doing up there in Canada? What do you think about this beautiful Corvette? Bob's finishing up. Bob, let's talk a little bit. The audience around the world cannot see it. You actually did a factory stripe on the front of this car. Nowhere else but just on the front of the car. Tell
okay,
us about
so,
that stripe.
So, yeah, man. So this, you know, we had a couple comments on the color already. So the color is actually, right, so Corvettes in C3s, right, that earlier model C3 Corvette, you could get in an orange, right? It wasn't
yes,
this orange, but it was an orange. And
tell
again,
us what you did different on this one, please.
So this one is actually a brand new C8 Corvette color, right, which is a beautiful color, C7, C8. They did use this color on all those newer Corvettes, which is an absolute beautiful color. When you see this thing in person, it has a ton of pearl in it. It's not just a basic orange paint that is base clear coat, solid color. This thing has a ton of green and yellow pearl. When this thing hits in the sun, it is all over the place. So we'll do some Instagram pictures for you guys later on once it's fully polished and ready to go, shined out and ready for the streets of South Florida. We'll get it outside, do some final shots. We'll get some close-ups so you can actually see the beautiful flake and pearl in this thing. But it is off that modern vet, and then we wanted
yeah,
to break it up, right? Because this orange is bright. I kid you not, very, very bright.
It is.
This is a very long car, right?
It
the
is.
Corvettes have always been very long front-end cars. The C3 model line was probably one of the longest front-end Corvettes
yes,
that was ever designed, and it was long. I'm telling you, when this whole front end was completely orange, we decided we had to break it up somehow. So we
is that where the stripe came from?
Yeah, we did do a little something on the front, which you guys will see later. It's not just a set of twin stripes. We didn't want to do something real thick down the center. I didn't want it to mimic like a motion, you know, Baldwin Motion Corvette, where it's like the thick black that came all the way back and then broke down the edge. I didn't want to push it that far because I didn't want it to look like something that it's not, right? So I actually did something that looked like it was GM design, a very solid one-piece, one-color stripe, all the way down the cowl, just the raised portion of the hood, and then I actually did it with like that GM design, quarter-inch spacing, then a quarter-inch stripe around it as well, so it has that GM flair to it. kind of like what you would have gotten if you ordered it that way.
And it's painted on. It's not a graphic, so there's no delineation between the paint layers as
yep.
well, Bub.
That's right.
The other thing I really like is one of the things that you love to do, Bub. Good morning to Jeff Graham out there. How are you doing, Jeff? One of the things you love to do, Bub, is door alignment and door actuation is everything to you, just
yep.
like everything. These were very hard doors to work, even from the factory, because you're actually pushing down into the escutcheon itself for the door to pop open. But again, once you were finished, Bub, it's just all you got to do is touch like that, and it has, if everybody listens, you'll hear that famous GM sound right there. All new weather strip. Everything matches on the corners the way it's supposed to be. All your gaps are correct, Bub. You went around with a paint stick to make sure your gaps were straight, and everything was correct. All new weather strip everywhere as well.
Yeah, it's it came together really well. You know, like I said, we are down to that final detail work. Jason, I don't know if you guys can hear it, is still running that polisher right now. This car's probably got, I'd say, 20, 30 hours worth of wet sanding and buffing time in it.
Yes,
as
it
sits now, we still probably have somehow another 4 hours worth of work that has to get squeezed down into like three by the time we're done dicking around. So we have a lot of work to get done, but this thing is going to look cherry when it's done.
And ladies and gentlemen, one of the things you'll notice that Bub and I have been doing is we've been posting this car up on social media, and we're going to be doing that with all of the projects. The next one you'll be seeing is a blue 68 Camaro convertible that we are going to be releasing pictures of, and then we'll follow it up with the completion episode so people get to kind of see the build in progress, Bob.
That's right, man.
Kind of the new fit and feel of everything.
No, these things are looking really good, man, and this thing is all the way down to, you know, even the little things inside the car, the three-point shoulder harness style seat belts in it,
yes.
So it's nice and modern, the GM style buckle, so it does have that modern flair and feel and comfort to it, but you have all the safety that you would want out of a newer car, even down to the Bluetooth Corvette style radio. When you get in, connects right away, and you can start jamming whatever you want.
You know, it's funny, Bob, when I jumped in this thing today for the first time, the owner does not like me driving this car for
yeah,
the obvious
not at all,
reasons.
Because you wreck everything.
But at least it had seats in it this time. But I had that really Corvette feel when I got into it. You did a tremendous job of recreating it, capturing it with the seats, the length of the leg well. It just had the right feel. When you looked out over that dash and that gauge pod, it all just felt 75 Corvette, man.
No, it's good, man. It's a super tight cruiser. You know, like I mentioned, I already drove it this morning, did some quality control drives on it, making sure fluid levels were good. Everything's fresh in the car. Tire pressures are set. Everything is straight on the car. It runs really good. Went and filled it up with gas to make sure the fuel gauge and all the gauges are working like they should. So everything is tip-top shape, ready for that final detail and assembly. And this client's going to be cruising the streets, man. I can't wait.
It's going to be great. I love the factory-style beauty wheels that you did.
Yeah,
these
may be going. We might be getting rid of those.
Oh, really?
Yeah, these might be going to like an 18-20 stagger.
Really?
Yeah, it's possible.
How would that handle on yesterday's cars? I mean,
it's actually, it'd be pretty tight. It'd be a nice, tight setup. I mean, these cars naturally were really tight as it is, but as you know, I did set the stance on this. I do a lot of custom suspension on
it.
So I set the stance and got this thing sitting at 26 inches in the front, 27 in the rear, nice little 1-inch stagger on it. So it may have that potential for a little meaty, modern-looking rim and tire on there when we're done.
Good morning to Greg out there. We'll see you later on this afternoon, Greg. And good morning to Francisco Gomez, Bob. Hey, Bub, a couple of things I want to ask you. When you're considering a restoration like this as one of the best in the business, what did you find with this restoration? You walk away learning something from every restoration. Is it the standard?
You know,
it costs more than you initially thought, or what did you learn on this
one? No, it's totally traditional restoration, man. It's like everything's already been hacked up, right? You already have to get in and clean up messes. Everything's going to take probably 3 or 4 times longer than originally anticipated or what you would think, right? Like, for example, to install a door panel on these cars realistically takes about stopwatch 2 minutes, 20 seconds, right? That's how long it takes to put a door panel on these cars, right? But because of the modifications someone else had already made to it, all the factory mounting holes are completely stripped out and, you know, there's threads missing from it. So now there's no way to properly attach them. So you have to go through and recreate all that. So now something that could be 2 minutes literally could take you three, four hours.
Sure.
So it could take forever long to get something super simple done. And that's just a part of restorations, man. You never know who's dicked with it, who's messed it up over the years, who's done what kind of ghetto modification to it. If doors aren't aligned right, you know, people just drill out holes. It's like, that's not the way it goes.
Sure.
If something's not fitting right, you have to make sure that it's done properly. Yeah. The car came from 75 GM. Perfect.
Yes, exactly.
So turn
yes.
it back to that, and the restoration will be beautiful. But everybody always has to dick with things, modify things, try to make things fit, drill holes bigger here, make them smaller here, glue crap on here. It's not the way you do it.
It doesn't. But for somebody out there from a technical standpoint who wants to do this kind of restoration, is it something that could be done by the average guy in his garage?
You know, I was talking with one of my really good friends last night that we do a lot of custom carts for, right? The golf carts. So
yes.
He does a ton in flipping business with, you know, golf cart restorations, golf cart builds, modifying, lifting, lowering, all kinds of crazy stuff with carts. And he was telling me even last night that in this area, there's no skilled craftsmen anymore that literally do anything. You know, we were talking about paint, for example, and he was like, Bub, there's absolutely no one that can paint better than you. Because we were looking at some of the stuff that we've had painted previously, and he's seen it, you know, firsthand. He's seen stuff that we've had our painters do, and he's seen stuff that I've painted. And he's like, listen, I don't care who it is, there's no one painting better than you, and that's just an art that no one has anymore. He's like, you know, any other guy that I take my stuff to, orange peel like crazy, looks like crap, has to spend hours and hours and hours of polishing and cutting and buffing and re-clearing because he burns through it and this and that. And it's true. You know, think about this in your mind. Is there anyone in South Florida
or anywhere
that could design, not anywhere, that could design and build a true lowrider that runs on the streets of West Coast? Absolutely not. With the graphics, with the airbrushing, with the gold flake, the etching everywhere, the etching on the suspension. Like, there is no chance.
But you twirl on, you see, you experience that a lot.
But those are true craftsmen. Like, those are people you can literally put an etching tool in someone's hand and let them go to town on the entire car, and there will not be a single flaw. There isn't a single person in South Florida that can do any more than mountain balance wheels and tires or put a wrap on a car. Like, that's it. There's no skilled artist in South Florida, and I'm just saying that because
that's
true.
That's a true statement.
Like, there's no one that could probably take a car all the way down to raw metal, custom fabricate all the panels, bring it back up to perfection, and do all the way through that seven-step polish and have it looking mirror quality shine when it's done.
And that's one of the reasons that
I'd love to see it if someone could.
We get hit on pretty hard because of the quality of what we do, but yet, you know, we catch a lot of crap in the media because there's a lot of haters. There's a lot of very jealous people, Bub.
Well, there is. It's you just got to see, you know, good stuff takes really long time. And that's the same thing with this car. It's like I mentioned, you could literally have one process that you would project taking maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes long. You could be on it for 3-4 hours just to make it perfect.
But
at the end of the day, like, when it's perfect, it's like I mentioned, when I drove this car this morning, and anyone who's driven a Corvette knows, like, that creaky little, every little bump, nick, road curvature, anything you hit, just a twist in the road, makes you hear, like, the sound of the dash crack, and you hear things like that going on. You don't have that with this car. Everything's tight, it's snug, the fitment is spot on, and it's the way it should have been done.
And, Bub, that's the thing about you. That's what makes you one of the best in the world today. That's why they call you the master, because you don't care. You've literally locked the front doors here.
No,
you don't
have,
want fans around you, and that's not a bad thing. You don't mind them, but you don't want any interruptions.
I got to work, man. I got to just get in the zone and work and start to finish. That's it. That's it. I don't have time to sit and dick around. And there's anybody out there in the industry that are real big names will do the exact same thing.
That's exactly right. You can't get the Paul Senior.
Nope.
We have a code to get into the back door.
Yep.
You don't walk through the retail door and just say, hey, I'm here. I'm going to take up your time.
That's true.
And I'm guilty of that. I've done that over the years. I've just allowed too many people to rob too much of my time, and it takes away because just the social media thing to share with everybody what you do alone takes Sundays and Saturday nights when you should be out doing other things.
Yeah.
But we try to share it with the world, Bub.
Yeah.
It's part of what we do, and we hope everybody enjoys that and appreciates everything we put in. Bub, what are we looking forward to next week? I know we're going to be moving into a 68 Camaro convertible.
That's probably what will be next week's show is going to be a final detail on a 68 Pro Touring ride that we've been doing. And let me tell you, dude, it's like the same thing.
That,
like,
motor sounds so good, Bub.
The client has been super, super patient with us on that car. He's gone through a lot of ups and downs with us here at BEM, a lot of growth, a lot of falling down. So thank you to that client out there. I'm just keeping him nameless right now, but thank you to him.
I think he's even watching, maybe.
But I will tell you this much, man. That car is going to be a nasty monster when it's done.
You have a way with small block Chevrolets, Bob.
I can tune a small block.
I mean, well, you can do big blocks. You can tune any money, but you any motor. But
I'll just let it roll. Like, you hear that cam just chopping. I mean, it sounds like a funny car sitting at the light.
My God, man.
Oh, yeah.
It does.
Total monster.
All while you're keeping the oil pressures up and everything like that.
Yeah.
You build it into that manner, in that realm. I was explaining.
Well, that's going to be, that car is that's a killer looking car, man. So it looks like it should. It looks like a 68 Camaro. First glance, looks like a 68 Camaro. That's all plain and original with, you know, the factory blue interior. I want to say that color, I'm going to throw this out there, it's called Nantucket Blue. Am I close?
I don't know.
I'm going to go with it, right?
Possibly.
I feel like that sounds good. I'm going to go with it. If I'm wrong, somebody correct me because I'm rolling with that one. I'm pretty sure it's Nantucket Blue. It's like a nice skyish dark blue metallic flake. I don't know, whatever.
Pretty, man.
Anyways,
somebody
this thing
scratched the
front looks
of it.
Like a, I know, somebody did scratch the front. It's pretty simple. 68 Camaro from the outside, but the stance of this thing now, the big brake kit, cross-drilled and slotted rotors popping through the massive 18-inch staggered rims.
Looks good, man.
Looks sick.
Looks really good.
So I can't wait to get this thing in the client's hands, man. I'm telling I know you flew the drone yesterday. What did you fly it into?
Nothing.
Mm-hmm. He was hovering actually over this car, knowing that I had a deadline of today to have this car done and ready to go. So he's probably going to be flying it over every car that I have a deadline on just to see if he can push limits and test waters and then drop it into the car and then wreck it. Ask him about the other car he hit yesterday. Go ahead.
It needs a top.
Yep. Convertible tops don't hold up to drone blades. Just leave it at that.
Especially expensive drones like that, Bub.
Yep.
But hey, it's all in bringing everybody great footage, Bub.
Yeah, not really.
I mean, just think about what it took to set this piece of the setup alone. Took a month to get it done. So
you guys stay
tuned
because we have a lot of hot releases that are going to be coming out right now. We have a lot of new products that are coming in that we are actually going to be doing promo installs on here at BEM. The floors right now look like crap, but as you can see, the background's getting done, all the gray, the red border, the trim. The floors will be all done in a super slick gloss finish, so we'll finally be up and running at our new custom-built location here in Lake Park, Florida. And there are some serious, serious rides rolling out of here right now, so you guys stay tuned.
I think, if I'm right, the Power Sports division may be ready, getting ready to open full-time. I've heard rumor of that. Any possibility of that?
Might be. Might be true.
Huh? Could that be true?
Might be true. You guys just have to stay tuned and see.
I'm getting a nod offset, ladies and gentlemen. So that means you're going to be seeing a lot coming out of the motorcycle division.
Not just going to be slick-looking C3 Corvettes or twin-turbo Audis coming through the door.
Race
or
bikes,
off-road Jeeps
motocross
coming through the door. Now it's going to be a full
Harleys
line of tricked-out baggers doing custom builds on motorcycles, doing jet ski performance, doing all kinds of custom tuning. So you guys stay tuned for that stuff because we have the guys in-house now ready to get it going.
Absolutely, Bub. We ask everybody to go out there and smash our subscribe key to our YouTube channel, Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. It's youtube.com/ Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. Ladies and gentlemen, please join us. Have everybody join us. The number, the 1,000th subscriber, Bub, gets we have a free gift pack going out to them.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
CVDs and all kinds of great stuff. All
right, I gotta go, dude. It's like way past. Listen, you're clicking away on my freaking deadline here. It's 12 o'clock. I've literally, by 3 o'clock, this has to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to do it for this episode of Doin' It Bubba Style. Bub, you are the master. Stay up with everything we're doing. I personally put those Instagram posts up at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports every night when I get home and I sit down.
That's right.
So I try to keep you up with the master and what he's trying to do. We try to bring it to you very up close and in person, different than anybody else in the industry. We want people to see exactly what you're doing, Bub.
That's right, man. You guys stay tuned for some of the sick rides we're going to be shooting this weekend here at BEM. This will be rolling out in the next 3 hours. Stay tuned for those Instagram posts. If you're not following us on Instagram, that is where we do all of our hottest releases. We are the most active on Instagram, but we also do transfer over to Facebook as well, where you're seeing this now, Instagram.com/ Bubba's Exotic Motorsports.
Anything you wanted to share with the world big going on in your world, Bub?
Yeah, no, not yet, man. We got a lot of stuff going on.
I'm talking about personally, Bub?
Yeah, no, personally, total gong show right now. So we're going to hold off on that for a little bit. I have a tornado I have to deal with at home, so I will.
These things happen when the hormones are going all over the place, right?
I'm out.
Right?
That's it. See you guys.
There he is, ladies and gentlemen, the master coming in for you on Friday, bringing you all the fun information. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to hear your technical ideas for every episode, and we ask you to please submit them to us at sales@bubbasexoticmotorsports.com or on any of our social media. We will feature your ideas right here. The 1,000th subscriber to our YouTube channel, and we're climbing up there, receives a free gift pack that comes with a t-shirt, CBD oil, graphics, whole nice swag bag coming to you from us here at DEM, so we can roll this channel up into the next level. Let's reach out to touch somebody's life in a very positive manner, ladies and gentlemen. Let's open the door for somebody whose hands are full. Let's put shoes on the bottom of somebody's feet who might have holes in them. And if you see a veteran or somebody standing on the corner that says, "We'll work for food," right there at 7-Eleven, grab him a protein shake and a power bar. It's cheaper than your designer cup of coffee. Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate you being part of the BEM family, and we thank you very much for taking us to number one here at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. Stay up with us on Instagram at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports, Bubba's Motorsports on Facebook, and on Twitter at Bubba's Hot Rod. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Let's get that number up and over the top so we can take it to the next level for you. Until next week, ladies and gentlemen, let's keep on doing it Bubba style.